How many of you think smartphones are making you dull? Please give me hand counts. Okay. Now, how many of you order groceries online? Nobody? Okay. Does it help you or does it make you dull? It helps us, right? It's easier. We do not need to go walk up to the store, buy something, come back. Instead, we just sit in one place, we switch on the phone, type what we want, we get it. It's easier.
So I'd like to rebut what Team B had stated in the last round. You had said that the value of work is lost, right? If I'm not wrong, that's what you said. So I'd like to just to tell you that the value of work is not exactly lost, because smartphones are actually helping you to finish the work which would take you, say, a week within a few days. You have to go to the library, you'd search for the books, you'd issue them, you'd do it. Fine, that's not wrong. I'm not saying books don't have the information you need. But it's just that you could sit at home and do the same thing in 2 days than take a week and do it in the library.
And Team B also said about binge texting and couples sitting at restaurants and all. But just because one couple or a few people do it, we can't generalize it for the entire population that almost everyone does it this way. And also now we can see that our respected judges have taken the time to come and judge this debate. I'm sure they also have smartphones. But do you see them using the smartphones right now? Do you think that makes them dull?
How Team B said, let me tell you that you told that now we are saying that usage of smartphones. Without using a smartphone, how do you become dull? If you just keep a smartphone, you don't become dull, right? You need to use. That's what I'm saying. And now, you told about GPS. What if a person is new to this place and he doesn't know anything? He doesn't know the language. What will he do? Please tell me.
Last round.
So, what we are, throughout this debate, what we were trying to say is just because one or two people use the smartphones for a bad purpose, we can't generalize it for the entire population. Like, if there's one person who uses a smartphone to make himself dull, there can be hundreds of us who use it for the right purposes.
Now, I'd like to conclude by saying that, now, all people have smartphones, people use smartphones, right? Now, smartphones was never created with the intention to make people dull. It is we who are making ourselves dull, right? It is depending on how we use it. It depends on who's using the smartphone. Because now, as he said, many people use it for the right purpose too. So it is not the smartphones that are making people dull. It's us who are making ourselves dull, depending on the way we use it. Thank you.
I'm sure everyone over here has used smartphones at least once in their life. Are you guys dull? Are you guys depressed and so sad. Are you guys dull? I don't think so. I see all of you smiling. See, it depends on how you use smartphones. If you use for a good purpose, it increases your knowledge and does not trouble you. But if you use it for a bad purpose, it indeed troubles you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There is an announcement. In the car parking, someone's car number by 3045 as an issue. Please go and check. Car number 3045. I'll be calling out the statements for 6 and 7. I request from here on the statements you'll be taking outside near the registration desk. Call number 6, Edify School, Namita and Aditi, Tramas, Chinmaya and Rohan, Devamata Central School, Manu and Lubna. This is call number 6. Call number 7, Ravishanka Vidya Mandir, Rakshit. Rakshita and Ankita, Vidyashilp Academy, Nikita and Nidhi, Green Valley English School, Rohit and Pratiksha. Please take your call sheets and statements outside. Call one on stage, please. I request everyone to maintain silence. Whoever needs to practice can go outside and practice. Okay, we'll be starting with the skirmish first round. Introduction, please.
Hari Om and a very good morning to our judges, our fellow debaters, and all our audience. I'm Avnish and he's my co-debater Prajwal, proudly representing Chinmaya Vidyalaya, CBSC Hubballi, standing strongly for the statement, AI cannot thrive in the future. Thank you.
Good morning to one and all present here. My name is Madhra Anand and this is my partner Ayushi Minocha. We are representing White Team Global School and we are firmly against the statement AI cannot thrive in the future. Thank you.
Good morning. I am Megha Nair and this is Aditi GK. We are representatives of Innisfree House School and we will be speaking for the statement artificial intelligence cannot thrive in the future.
AI stands for artificial intelligence. What is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence is also known as machine intelligence and it is developed by humans and put into machines so that machine can work on their own.
Examples of such devices are Alexa, Amazon Echo, and robots like Sophia and iPal. These devices work on programs put into them, but the drawback is that they cannot rectify their mistakes. If there is some loophole found, it would lead to some destructive consequence. And we, being humans, are smart enough and know that prevention is better than cure. And therefore, we will not allow the artificial intelligence to thrive in the near future. Thank you.
Alexa, Siri, Cortana are the names of the AIs we know. As we all know, these are the creations of great forward-thinking minds that we know in today's world as AI. But what exactly is AI?
Well, the theory and development of computer systems that are able to perform tasks that normally require human intelligence, such as speech recognition, visual perception, decision-making and translation of languages, is what we currently call artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is just a futuristic notion and not progress in motion. Therefore, artificial intelligence will not thrive in the future, at least not in the near future.
In contradiction with my friends in Team B, you told that Alexa, Siri and all are developing. Well, I would like to tell you that life is like a circle. We start from zero and we end to zero. That is, we start from the same point where we end. So we started from nothing. And now the world is developing. But then we'll realize that this development is leading to so many consequences, causing health problems and certain other problems too, because of which we, as I told in the first round, being smart will not let it flourish in future. And also you told about Elon Musk. He warned us about artificial intelligence taking over humans. And my friend, we all are smart enough and we will consider this as a warning and we'll not let it do the same, because we being humans are very dominating and we don't want anyone else to take over us.
And now the artificial intelligence, thank you.
Let me make something very clear. Artificial intelligence indicates the rise of machinery and robots, human creations that will never truly replace the human race. Sure, people may learn to live in harmony with a metal and iPads and robots, but they will never truly become subservient to them. Furthermore, when gigantic tycoons of the tech industry like Elon Musk have expressed well-grounded qualms against the progress of artificial intelligence, how can we expect it to thrive in the future? It's people like those that drive artificial intelligence. And when they're not down for its progress, it will definitely not thrive in the future.
Everyone and everything has a hamartia or a fatal flaw. AI's fatal flaw is emotions. Although an artificial intelligence can perform the cognitive functions of our brains, like processing, analyzing, and storing data, it cannot express emotions. It cannot analyze the situation and react to humans in a way.
I would like to continue my point. Technophobes is a source of new anxiety, and it is an anxiety in which a person has a fever of advanced technology and complex devices. So if a human know that they have problem with development of artificial intelligence, why they will allow it to develop? So AI will not thrive in future.
Well, I don't agree with the point said by team B. You told that the change happens in artificial intelligence, but we don't know whether the change is good or bad. And as told by great scientist Sir Stephen Hawking, he warned us that artificial intelligence will overcome humans in future, which is a bad thing. And we humans, taking this as a warning, will not accept this change and will not support artificial intelligence to thrive in future. So it will not thrive in future.
We would like to continue team A on that fact. So I said that AI has been programmed by the humans. So we are the ones who are feeding the information of human emotions and feelings. So that is contradicting team C. So that artificial intelligence will start thinking like how we humans will. And for that, they will also start having such human emotions.
Well, I can contradict team C. Intelligence enables control. We are feeding intelligence into a machine, and everyone who is intelligent can control someone else, and therefore AI might control something. So they can control us.
To rebut what you said that AI can express human emotions. So are you saying that artificial intelligence can show the finer qualities of humans like compassion, empathy, and love? Do you think they can express these sort of emotions?
Let me put things into perspective here. Let me introduce you to this term called technophobes. Now, technophobes relate to this marginalized society, this minority, where people are usually ostracized. So it's people like women in rural villages, OBCs, poor people, scheduled castes, etc., who live in a bubble. They feel threatened by the advent of such technology. So when things like artificial intelligence start taking shape, these people are adversely affected. A study shows that the odds of them being able to control their anxiety and worry is 95% more when they are exposed to even the tiniest wisp of artificial intelligence or any such technology.
Last round.
Okay, I want to contradict team B on the fact of Alexa. Alexa was introduced in 2014 in USA and it gained great popularity. And it was introduced in India in 2016, and about 1,000 of videos are viral in YouTube trolling Alexa. So people know that it has many disadvantages, so they are not liking Alexa, so they will not allow AI to thrive in future.
Also, in contradiction to team B, artificial intelligence can have emotions, but it cannot replace original intelligence. It's like an plastic plant replacing an original plant that is grown through a seed. It can't be replaced. And also, in this complex situation, an individual would not allow artificial intelligence to take over human beings, rendering themselves as a mere piece of objects controlled by humans. With this, we think we have done justice to the statement. Thank you.
And it saves our time. So AI is there.
as we all know, there was a viral video on YouTube off late of this robot known as Sophia, who was artificially intelligent. And in the video, it's seen that the robot is telling the her audience that she will destroy the human race. And after this, there was a huge speculation on whether they should dismantle that robot or not. This proves without a shadow of doubt that AI is still in its infant stage, and we will not let it grow further because it threatens the safety of our future as human beings.
And I know that there are some like Team B who say that AI is the way of the future and that it's nature's call or, you know, a push to evolution. But I would just like to say that when you say that artificial intelligence will thrive in the future, you are basically advocating a vicious cycle where we are destroyed by the thing that we created. Because they have fatal flaws that we can correct. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, judges.
Call to on stage, please. Introduction, please. Introduction. Yes, sir.
Good morning to one and all present here. My name is Neelam Khambede and this is Ashita Jain, and we are against the statement Indians are not positive in general.
Jai Gurudev, and a very good morning to one and all present here. I'm Smriti Shreya and he's Anupam Verma. We are from SSRVM Bangalore South. And we are strongly for the statement, Indians do not have a positive, they are not positive in general.
Good morning to one and all present here. I am Dhruv Shah and this is Mohammed Riham. We represent the Yenapoya School, Mangalore. We are going against the statement, Indians are not positive in general. Thank you.
Start.
Mahatma Gandhi once said, keep your thoughts positive because your thoughts become your words. Keep your words positive because your words become your behavior. Keep your behavior positive because your behavior become your habits. Keep your habits positive because your habits become your values. And keep your values positive because your values become your destiny.
Let's observe the India today and the India 70 years ago. It was a shaken economy and we were reeling from the after effects of nearly two centuries of colonial rule. But the people of India, with a strong mindset and a positive outlook, worked hard to overcome all our problems and are developing into the world's fastest growing economy right now. We are a global force to be reckoned with, and this is only possible due to the positive mindset of the Indians. Over to you.
As Indians, don't you think we're all involved in the process of blame game?
For example, even if there's a road accident happening, we all blame the government for like not building the roads properly or not using their funds properly. We blame everything and everyone around us and find the negative things in them and not even care about what negative things we have or what positive things they have.
We poke our noses into others' matter. We try finding faults in what others do. We don't see the positive side. We focus on what happens negative. We are very superstitious. We believe in many, we have many superstitious beliefs. For example, when you say you're not supposed to cross the road if a cat crosses before you, that's because you're negative and you're thinking about something negative is going to happen to you in future. This proves that we are negative. Over to Team C. Thank you.
Our positive actions combined with our positive thinking results in success. Now in India, a country like India, which is moving towards development and is almost reaching success. Now success is a part and an aspect of positivity.
Now, we know that India is a very religious country. We have people of different castes, creed, color. We still remain in harmony. We still remain in peace. Why? We hope for a better India. Now, in religion, we pray to God. We are grateful for Him and we hope for the best. Now, hope. Hope is a key word here. Why? Because it is positive. You think and you hope for the best at this point.
Let's take an example of our Prime Minister, Achhe Din. Now, when he is spreading the idea and the concept of positivity to all the Indians, how can we term Indians are not positive in general? Thank you.
I would like to ask my worthy opponents at Team B. You talked about road accidents, but have you noticed that the government is supporting actively the good Samaritans who come forward to help the injured people? Isn't that positive? Okay, so if Indians are positive, we can see that they have made their mark in the world. Let's take, for example, Abdul Kalam. He was born in extreme poverty, but look at him. He has, due to his positive mindset, he has overcome all the obstacles in his path and has become the missile man of India. He has even received the Bharat Ratna. Let's take Kalpana Chawla. She is the first Indian woman in space. How was that achieved? By a positive mindset, of course. Also, let's talk about the Mangalyaan mission. It was made at a budget lower than the budget used to make the films Gravity or The Martian. This is definitely a feat attributable to the...
You said about Abdul Kalam and Kalpana Chawla. We're generalizing India at this moment. Usually, Indians play the devil's advocate. Like, they fault out the mistakes in everything and everything. They don't think positive. They're not optimistic. They're only thinking about the negative things.
And as you said, India is a developing country. Yes, we agree to that. Why is that so? Because we're still in the negative thoughts. We told about the government. We did not say government is not supporting us. We said they are, but we find faults in the government rather than correcting our behaviors. Because that's road accidents. It's because of you, not because we blame the government saying the roads are not proper, though the accident is because of you. And that's where we're lacking. We think negative.
And they find a small fault and make it a big thing. They make a mountain out of a molehill. Isn't that very negative? Over to you.
Now, what is development? Development is a positive change. Development is something which increases or is a growth in something. Now, India is one of the biggest developing countries and has the highest growth in the GDP rate. Why? See, literally, India is moving forward. India is positive. If India is positive, why will not its citizens be positive?
India is a land of culture and festivals. Festivals bring celebration. Celebration brings happiness. And happiness is a part of positivity.
I would like to contradict Team B when they talked about how people criticize you. Well, criticism can be taken as a positive manner. People try to make themselves better every other day. See, this shows that they are positive. They take this criticism in and they try to implement it in real life.
We see reforms taking place each and every now and then. Isn't this positivity in our country? Thank you.
Team B, you said that I'm taking out Abdul Kalam and Kalpana Chawla and people like that. Okay, but have you seen the people like the auto rickshaw driver or the local greengrocer? They are singing and laughing and generally happy about their lives, even though they're facing so many troubles, inflation, shortage. Isn't that positivity?
I would also like to mention our Indian culture. Positivity is deep-seated in our culture. In fact, it forms the basis of our Indian culture. Indian culture teaches us values, our communication with each other, etc., form an important component of our culture. And this teaches us values and beliefs which we strongly believe in. And this is formed only because of positivity, the positivity that we have within us. India is an emerging economy. We've seen rapid growth in all major sectors. Take communication and transport, for example, or maybe agriculture. From a country that used to import agricultural products, we've now attained self-sufficiency.
I would like to contradict Team B. As you said, Team C, as you said, people, we face criticism. Okay, you said we can take it in a positive way, but when people criticize them, it's negative. Criticism can't, you can't say criticism is positive.
And you said about auto drivers always being happy and everything, but auto drivers always cheat us. Don't you think about that? And doesn't that mean they don't want to like interact with others? They don't want to have a positive life with other people?
Okay, India is a developing country. Most of the people are below the poverty line. Richer are getting richer and poorer become more poor. And that's because of negativity. No one is happy with their life. They interfere in others' life because they want to become like them. They're not satisfied with their own life. And that's where negativity comes in. How can you say the country is positive when they are not happy in their own lives? Thank you.
Now my friends in Team B are speaking about how India is developing because it is negative. According to them, if it wasn't negative, it would be a developed country. Now my friends, India is a population of 1.2 billion. Now if we all were negative, we would have been an underdeveloped country instead of being a developing country.
Why do you think Narendra Modi is the president right now? He gave the people what is the prime minister right now. He gave the people what he wanted. He promised that the people will get Achhe Din. Achhe Din is positive days or good days. See, people had hope. People believed him. People had faith in him. This shows that Indians are positive. They believe that being positive is right.
Every year, when IPL comes, we listen only one thing. E Salah Cup Namde. What is it? Indian Premier League. We all Indians believe in the franchise, which is going to win next year. This is a positive change. This is positivity. Thank you.
Last round.
You said that we criticize people, Team B. However, what I'd like to say is that people generally have a reason to criticize the government. We wanted to become better. And it is not that we're negative. You said that we're still developing because we are not positive. But I'd like to say that for a country that was thrust into the hands of the Indian leaders just 70 years ago, do you think it's really possible to achieve a totally developed nation? I definitely think not. However, we are on the path to progress. Positive thinking is not just a tagline. It changes the way we behave. And when I think positive, it's not only me who feels better, but also everybody around me. Thus, I'd like to say that through our arguments, we have substantial evidence that the Indian mindset is generally positive. Thank you.
Okay, as both the teams, Team A and Team B, Team C said that India is a developing country because we are positive. If we are so positive, then why aren't we developed like America? Why are we just developing? And
you said about IPL and how we are always looking forward to it. There's so much match fixing and happening in that. How can that be positive?
People are only praised when they win. When they lose, no one tells them, well done, or you have done really well. You're just criticized. You're like, you didn't win, that's so bad. So that shows your negative thinking. When you're saying people are Isal Cup Namda, it's like you're just saying you want to win. But when you lose, it comes to your negative side. And we conclude that you cannot have a positive life and a negative mind. Your mind has...
Over to you.
Now my friends in Team B again spoke about if we were so positive, why aren't we developed like America? Just like I mentioned in the last round, we are a population of 1.2 billion people, not 700 million people. It takes a lot to overcome underdevelopment.
Now you talked about how match fixing takes place. Exactly a point. Match fixing is put aside and still people believe that their teams will perform well. This is positivity. I have a question for both the teams. Over here, we hope to win. Why? Because we are positive and we are Indians, aren't we? So we are positive. Everybody in this room is being positive about it.
I would like to conclude by saying, India is a land which has learned from its past, lives for the future, lives in the present and will hope for a positive future. Thank you.
Thank you. Call 3 on stage, please.
sheets are allowed. Return sheets are allowed. Call 3. Sir, call 3. Only return sheets are allowed, no gadgets. Ready? Introduction, please. Introduction, please.
Good morning, respected teachers, judges, and my dear friends. Today, we, the students of Royal Concord International School, Jacqueline and Sarah, are strongly against the statement that it is okay for children to fight with their parents.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Pranav Isaac, and this is my partner, Lohit. And we are from Dev Mata Central School, Banaswadi. And we're talking for the statement, it is okay for children to fight with their parents.
Check. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. I'm Tejaswini, and this is Gayatri Rajesh. We are from the PSBB Learning Leadership Academy. We are here to stand strongly against the statement that it is okay to fight with your parents. Start.
Mata Pita Guru Devo. It means that your parents are equivalent to God. They know what's best for you, as they have your best interests at their heart. They think about your entire future, while all we think about is our immediate need.
Your parents know what's best for you and love you unconditionally. You love them the same way. Would you want to fight with someone like that? And in case you want to put your point in front of them, you put your foot firm on the ground and tell what you need.
This and fighting are completely different terminologies. Thank you.
Denying or attempting to deny a child from the joy of argument or reason is an act of evil, and not letting the child express his or her feelings.
Fighting is just an intense way of expressing ourselves. Is it wrong to express ourselves? All of us do it, but it's just a different way to do it.
So having open communication between the children and parent is the only factor which is going to lead to a parent and child relationship. And to make that relationship better, the child needs to express his feelings to his parents openly and honestly. He needs to be transparent enough to convey all his needs and even fight it out sometimes with his parents. Over to you.
Indian culture has always focused on respect, freedom of individual, and liberalism. And fighting goes against these very basic principles. We stand here not against expressing our opinion, but against fighting. Because fighting will lead us nowhere. It will not get us what we want. It will not help us achieve our goals. We need to understand that there is a clear line of difference between fighting and argument. And we are open to argument. We are open to debate, but not to fighting. Parents are our philosophers, our guides, someone who is there to show us the right path. And we should not fight with them. Rather, we should tell them what we feel. From Malala Yousafzai to APJ Abdul Kalam, every idol whom we admire have become the idols we admire because they did not fight with their parents. They told their parents what they wanted. They told them what they felt. They had a productive argument, which is not called as fighting.
Let's take a case scenario in which a child is asking his parents for a mobile phone. In the first case, when the child has carefully thought out what he wants to go tell his parents in a pleasant way, the parents have a 50-50 chance of saying yes. But if the child is resentful, disrespectful, and does not listen to parents, well, he does not get his mobile phone anytime soon. Every decision that the parents take for the child is carefully analyzed by them.
And I would like to rebuttal Team B's point. They say that fighting is an intense way of expressing one's points. Well, how intense can a fight get? And this intense way is completely wrong with parents. It could also end relationships. And trust me, you don't want bad blood with parents. Thank you.
I'm very astonished at your conjecture. Fighting is not always physical. It can even go verbally. We're just expressing ourselves. We're just telling whatever we have in our mind. Psychological experts say that fighting is one of the most frank ways to express what is in our heart.
If the child finds a space to disagree, then he is more clear with his parents, and then the parents may put his or her viewpoint, and then the child gets the larger picture and understands the situation.
Team C, you said fighting is not expressing yourselves. I would like to repeat what I said in round one. Fighting is just an intense way to express ourselves. We mentioned that in the round one itself. Thank you.
Our parents don't live under a rock. They know what is good for us. They are aware. In fact, they are more experienced and mature than us. There is no need to accept everything that they say, but there is a need for argument, not fighting. And Team B has not understood the difference.
Why would you want to express your opinions in an intense way? Parents are our well-wishers. They're not your stark enemies for you to fight with them. You can have a productive argument, a discussion. Parents do not have any selfish motives behind compelling you, showing their authority over you. It's all for your welfare. And when we fight with our parents, we end up harming ourselves and them emotionally, which is not productive. When we fight, it's not two people expressing their opinions, it's two egos trying to prove themselves right, which will not be productive, especially when it's between parents and you, when both of us are working towards your goals. Thank you.
We would like to rebuttal Team B's statement. We were not referring to physical, we were referring to verbal aspects. And when we fight verbally also, we can lose self-control, we might have emotional overload, and the logic in our head fails to engage.
If you want to disagree to something your parents have told, you can have a respectful discussion, a mindful disagreement of opinion. You don't always have to use bad words and disrespect them. Thank you.
Team C, as you keep talking, I get more and more tempted to counter your point. I like to say that we're repeating this one more time, that fighting doesn't have to be always physical, you know. It can even be verbally. We're repeating this for the third time. It doesn't have to be physical. It can be verbal.
Verbal fights do not...
Team C has related fighting to very much of negativity. Fighting does not always have negative results. It can also yield good results. How about we take the example of Mahendra Singh Dhoni? Who doesn't know him? All of us know him. He's the former Indian cricket captain. He fought with his parents for his cricket career. Would we be having a captain like him if he didn't fight that time?
Let's take another example, Michael Jackson. His father didn't let him go from the band all of their brothers had made. And if he did not leave and make his own decision and fight with his father, we wouldn't have been seeing the great Michael Jackson we all know today.
Even verbal disagreements, verbal fights can harm you psychologically. We are not stating that fight needs to be physical. Even mental, you can get into a mental trauma when you fight with your parents.
Children think of suicide. There are suicide rates among teenagers is increasing. And one of the major reasons for this is disagreement with parents. Parents have accumulated wisdom. They know what is good for you. They have gone through your phase. And you had mentioned about the, if a child is not given the joy of argument, his childhood is not good. You argue with your parents, try to convince them instead of fighting with them. Fight is intense. Why would you choose an intense means to convince your parents when you can do it in a better way, in a subtle way, in making them understand and convincing them that what you're saying is right? And for your kind information, Mahendra Singh Dhoni did not fight with his parents. He convinced his mom that he will do good in sports if he actually is given the opportunity.
Last on.
And rebuttal team B statement, you've got the definition of fighting all wrong. Fighting is when you bring resentment into an argument.
And Mahendra Singh Dhoni had a mindful disagreement of opinion. He told his parents that he would prove them wrong. He did not fight with them in a verbal or physical manner. Thus, we would like to rest our case by saying, in case you do disagree with your parents, as a mature individual, you should try and convince them in a civilized manner and communicate with them without fighting or arguing. Thank you and have a very nice day.
I experience gratitude as my friends in Team A and Team C are putting up such invalid points. Okay, now I like to start by saying it's better for the children to fight it out with their parents within the family than go out and get insulted.
Letting off steam and expressing ourselves helps us to get fear, anxiety and tension out of us. And Team C said that our parents, Team C said that our parents have been in the face of, in the same face as us. But they weren't in the society as what we are in right now. We can't compare their childhood and our childhood. There's a huge difference between theirs and ours.
So we like to conclude by saying, it is okay to fight with your parents because you need to express your views and you need to convey all the thoughts in your mind, or else you may be just keeping it all in and then it'll lead you to depression. So just convey to your parents, fight it out, and then you all will be in a good relationship. Thank you.
I would like to contradict what Team B said. Again and again, they have failed to understand the clear line of difference between argument and fighting. For good ideas, we need human interaction. We need argument. We don't need fighting. Fighting is something that will lead us nowhere, and that is what we stand for. Our parents may not have been in the society at that time. We are not saying blindly follow your parents. We are saying tell your parents what you feel. Make them understand what you feel. Don't blindly follow them, but don't blindly fight with them. That is what we stand for, and that is what we want to make you understand.
Team B had stated that it's better to convey your emotions to your parents instead of getting into depression. Convey it. Thanks for stating that. Convey it, but convey it in a more subtle way. Fighting is not the thing. And you're saying when you disagree with your parents, you'll have to show it to them. Otherwise, you might go out and you might get harmed by other people. You might get insulted by other people. Fighting is not the way. They're not your stark enemies. They're your well-wishers. They do not enjoy fighting with you. Parents have better jobs, but they're doing it for your sake.
I'll be giving a call sheets for call 8, 9 and 10. Call number 8, Gopalan National School, Gopika and Arushi, Chinmaya Vidyalaya CBSE, Arish and Pavan, Kenshri School, SV Anand Krishna and Fauzia. Please collect your statements outside near the registration. Call 9, Royal Concord International School, Vedika and Nandini, Sanska CBSE School, Jilak and Ishan, Achieve School, Mohammed and Avik. This is call number 9. Call 10, Sacred Heart English Medium School, Pramod and Shivraj, Vidyashilp Academy, Manisha and Lakshmi, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Vidya Mandir South, Ankit and Shreya.
Call 4 on stage, please. Introduction, please. Introduction. Can
Bad
you all
habits.
Pay attention? Sorry. Can you all maintain silence, please? Whoever needs to practice, please go outside. Do not make noise here. Introduction, please.
Bad habits are like soft beds. Once you get in, it's very difficult to get out. Hari Om and a very good morning to everyone. I am Kshama Wari and my co-debater Anjali Niralgi, proudly representing Achinmaya Vidyalaya CBC School,
are standing strongly against the statement, bad habits don't make a person bad. Thank you.
Good morning, honorable judges and our phenomenal audience. My name is Kanda.
And I'm Shashank J. Rao. And we are thoroughly pleased to be given this stage in the form of Verbattle 2018 to represent Primus Public School.
And we will be speaking strongly for the statement, bad habits do not make a person bad.
Good morning to one and all present. I am Chanakya and this is Jatin. We are representing Achieve School of Education and we are strongly against the statement, bad habits don't make a person bad.
Start.
So let us start our round by understanding what are bad habits. Bad habits are the mistakes committed on and on repeatedly and which bring a negative pattern in our behavior. And who are bad persons? The bad person is how is he judged? He's judged on his deeds. If a bad person commits something, a bad thing, he has a negative pattern in his behavior. Because of his bad habits, he is judged as a bad person.
A bright white sheet of paper with a single black spot. Everyone concentrates on the black spot and not on the paper. In the same way, a person with a single small bad habit, nobody focuses on his other actions, rather concentrates on his bad habit, hence making the person bad.
So this, through this we can understand that if we have some bad habit, this will lead a person to become a bad. Thank you.
There was a story. A long time ago, a woman had to be stoned to death for adultering. This matter was brought to Jesus. Jesus thought for a second and said, "He that is without sin among all of you may cast the first stone." Nobody could cast the stone, as everyone had sinned at least once in their life.
Everyone is flawed. All of us, even present in this hall, have at least one bad habit. But does this make us bad? We are all flawed, but we are not bad. Thank you.
George Washington Carver had once stated that 99% of failures were from people who had the habit of making excuses.
Huffington Post and Times of India stated that bad habits should be replaced by the good ones. WHO tells that good health is complete physical, mental, social, and emotional health to be stable, and bad habits do not allow them to happen. And bad habits can include like surfing on internet of corrupt websites, then biting nails and sleeping late, binge eating of junk food, binge drinking, which spoils your health. And sleeping late like affects your health drastically, because when you sleep at night, there are a lot of hormonal secretions and chemical reactions in your body which takes place. And when you sleep at day, which doesn't take place. Sleeping late also makes you lazy, dull, and that is a sign of a bad habit or negativity. Thank you.
Nicely explained by my friend in team B, but I would like to contradict the point that he told it is a mistake. When the mistake is committed repeatedly, it is called a bad habit.
And this bad habit is making the person bad. And coming to our point, let us see what are the bad habits. Drinking, smoking, right from drinking, smoking, to all the small bad habits like biting nails, telling lies, disrespecting our elders.
For example, a student asks permission from the parents for a group study. Instead of doing that, he goes and has every unwanted enjoyment. This is a mistake which is not corrected. He repeats it, which becomes a bad habit of the student. And this makes him a bad person.
Also taking another example, there are two persons, and the first person thinks the second person as good. But this second person has a bad habit of smoking. When this he is smoking, thank you.
Now, I would like to name a few bad habits that probably most of us have done at some point in our lives, or continue to do even at this point. Procrastination. Procrastination done in a mindful way can actually help you. It gives you the time you require. Instead of continuously going in the hamster ball, running around, continuously panicking, it gives you the time to turn those problems that you thought about into phenomenal feasible solutions that will help you achieve something.
Steve Jobs once said he'd give the most difficult task to the most laziest person, because he would find the easiest way to solve it. Thank you.
William Durant had once said that when a person, whatever a person does repeatedly, that becomes his habit. When you repeatedly make a mistake, that becomes a bad habit. When you repeatedly give difficult tasks to lazy people, knowing that it is not in their capacity to do it, it is also a bad habit. You are voluntarily setting them up for failure. How can it not be a bad habit?
Positive psychology people have told that habits define a person. So you have bad habits that makes you bad. And you eat junk, binge eating of junk food makes you unhealthy, and you don't have energy to go or do your work continuously. You won't be flawless. Thank you. Over to Team A.
The quote told by my friend in Team B is nowhere related to the statement of bad habits making a person bad or not. Please stick to the statement and what you are speaking.
Also, a contradicting Team C, even they are not sticking to their point. The example told of the junk food is nowhere related. The junk food only harms that person, whereas a bad person is one who harms others too. Let us come to our point. Take an example. Most of us consider biting nails is a bad habit. When do a person bites nails? When he is afraid of something of wrong or bad. But we give an excuse of the circumstances, whereas the bad habit is making the person bad.
We would like to illustrate another example.
Hey, give me my money.
Why should I?
I want to drink more. Here, we saw that a person who has a bad habit of drinking comes to home and harasses his wife. In the same way, when he has something bad habit, he is harming the other person and making himself as a bad person. Thank you.
On the contradiction that Team A placed upon Team C, I would like to point out that eating junk food may be a bad habit, but it doesn't make you a bad person. Eating junk food doesn't make you a bad person. Having those sorts of mild bad habits won't make you a bad person. Here are some more bad habits that in fact help people around you, because bad habits are not always bad, make you a bad person.
Lying in certain situations may not be bad if it's to help someone else. This shows that the person who is lying has sensitive to the other person's feelings.
I would like to contradict both Team A and Team B One, if you eat continuously junk food as we had stated, you lose your mental abilities. Junk food is called junk because it is useless. When you eat useless food, even your brain becomes useless. Every action always has a reaction. When you eat junk food, it has an effect on your health, mentally and physically. You get boredom, you don't go anywhere, you stop doing your tasks. Benjamin Franklin had once stated that when your bad habits are subtracted from your good habits, that is what your legacy in the world is. When your good habit was that you used to, emphasis on used to, go and play, complete your work, etc. And now your bad habit is eating junk food. That is what your legacy is. Your legacy is that you are just a person who was spending so much on junk food. That would be your legacy. And if you don't...
Last round.
Firstly, in contradiction with my friend in team B, he told, something done bad for a good cause is good. But no, you consume poison little or too much. It will cause death.
And coming to our point, who is a bad person? How is he judged? A person who has bad thoughts is a bad person. And our physical and mental are both correlated. What we think, we do. And what we do, accordingly we think. If we think something bad and we have some bad habit, we are making ourselves bad.
Each one of us in our childhood are told not to do any bad habit. Why? Because this brings a negative character in the child, which makes them a bad person. With this, we think we have done justice to our statement.
Standing strongly against the statement, bad habits don't make a person bad. Thank you.
At the last moment, I would like to raise a contradiction to Team C. They stated quoted a quote from Benjamin Franklin saying that if your bad habits are subtracted from your good, then that makes your legacy. But I don't think anyone here has enough bad habits to outweigh their good. I don't think that anyone here has enough bad habits to make for and outdo what they have done right. I believe that we are all flawed, but this does not make us bad. We are humans, and to be human is to be imperfect, but to correct that is divine. Thank you.
Warren Buffet has said that habits are too light to detect, but they are too heavy to break afterwards once you detect them. So if you continuously have a bad habit in a short period of time also, it will have an adverse effect on everything that you treasure.
Okay, bad habits have a very negative impact on your health and your career. Do you all know Macaulay Culkin, the small cute guy in Home Alone? He is now a drug addict and it has a very negative impact on his career. He was such a good artist in his childhood, but now people no more respect him. I would like to conclude telling that bad habits die hard. Thank you.
Thank you. Call 5 on stage, please. Call number 10, one team has not taken this statement. Sacred at call number 10, Sacred Heart English Medium School, Vidya Shilpa Academy, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Vidya Mandir South. Call number 10, Sacred Heart Pramod and Shivraj, do we have them here? Sacred Heart School, Pramod and Shivraj. Vidya Shilpa Academy, Manisha and Lakshmi, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Vidya Mandir South. I request everyone again, do not off your mic.
please do not off your mic. When you don't have anything to talk, please place it opposite side. Yes, return sheets are allowed. We understand that we all have a different thoughts on every statement, but it will be great if you can support by being silent. Introduction, please.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. My name is Kiara Korsahi, and this is Supreeta Perry, and we represent Vidya Shilp Academy. Our statement for today is, parents don't know what's best for us always, and we are strongly against the statement.
Good afternoon, one and all present here. My name is Rushil and this is Pashyan. We are standing from SSRVM East and we are going to be standing for the statement, parents don't know what's good for the children always.
Greetings to one and all present here. I'm Abhinav Srinivas and this is my partner Shreya Abhimesh. We are representing class 9 of Kentree School and today we are strongly against the statement, parents don't know what is best for their children always.
Start.
We would like to start by saying, our parents know how to push our buttons because they install them.
Our parents were once teenagers. They went through the changes that we're going through right now. They made the mistakes which we can avoid. They brought us into this world. They want what's best for us. Their advice and their consult is one which we can rely upon with utmost certainty.
Friends, in today's competitive world, if we are looking towards success, friends aren't always the ones we should rely on, as they too are seeking success and they may want to pull you down sometimes. Our parents, however, always want the best for us and will support us no matter what happens.
How many of us hate it when our parents make us do our homework? Well, that's because they want to succeed. They want you to succeed in studies. How many of us hate it when we can't go for a party? Who knows what could have happened to us at that party? They have our well-being and success in the long term in mind.
The number of examples of underprivileged workers working day and night.
Okay, so like everyone wants to be independent, right? I'm pretty sure that everyone here is quite independent, like you're not completely dependent on your parents. Like all of you do your own work yourselves, right? So
in this busy world, in this busy and fast world, your parents can't spend every single minute of their life with you. They can't keep protecting you from the outer world all the time. They can't stay behind you. They can't keep advising you all the time. You need to be exposed to this modern world. Parents were grown up in the environment which was a little backward before. Now the technology has improved a lot. The world has changed. They are not exactly aware of what's happening today. We, being outside, know most of the things what's in the world. So we know better what decision is to be taken for ourselves. We know ourselves better than anyone else. Thank you.
So let us all imagine two people who are extremely irrational and absolutely immature. So when they become parents, they see that little bundle of joy. They see that dependent soul waiting for them to make decisions for it. At that time, they recognize their responsibility for that bundle of joy, and this is the first sign of their maturity.
And let's take a fact into consideration. No parent is born perfect. However, parenting is a learning process. And even while they're learning, parents tend to know what's best for their children. It's a common conception. Matra Devo Bhava, Pitra Devo Bhava. And I think that pretty much summarizes what we're trying to say. Thank you.
I would like to rebuttal Team B's point by saying that even though there is a time gap in our generations and there may be new comings of technology in our world, we still grow up to be our parents. We still resemble what they do in their childhood. They are experienced. We do exactly what they do. It's a recurring pattern. Our parents know us inside and out. They know our strengths and weaknesses. Let me tell you, the tireless and sleepless nights that they're working for you today is something nobody else in this room is going to sacrifice for you.
In China, when the one-child policy was being followed, a couple was made to abandon their second child in a market. Although this may seem like a bad decision they took to most people, it turned out to be the greatest decision
as the child Ki Fang is now leading a well off life in the US with an American family.
In the words of Robert Broad, our parents' love is whole, no matter how many times divided. Over to you.
Rebutting to what Team A said, I would like to tell that suppose your parents are protecting you all the time. In this generation, you're telling that parents are the loud ones, they care for you. Yes, I do agree. You need to follow what they say, but they're just facilitators. We are the decision makers. We need to make the decisions for ourselves. And secondly, when we are protected by our parents, and suddenly when there's a situation that we need to come out into this modern world, when we come out, we don't know what's happening around us. We don't know what's right. We don't know what's wrong. Then what will you do? What are you going to do that time? You can't again go tell, Mama, can you tell me what do you want me to do at this situation? You are in the modern world. You can't always be dependent. Being independent reduces the burden of your parents also. Thank you.
Now let's take the example of some of the most amazing people of this nation. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, Mr. Narendra Modi, Dr. Dhirubhai Ambani, Rajnikanth for that matter. They all had humble beginnings. Were their beginnings luxurious? No, their parents couldn't afford it. Yet they are so successful today. Why is that so? It's not because their parents gave them what we define as best, all the luxuries and pleasures of life. Their parents gave them what they could to the best of their abilities, their experience, their hard work, their dedication, and their point of view.
Well, when these people saw their parents work hard, when they saw each drop of sweat dripping from their forehead, that each drop was a motivation. It was an inspiration for them to make use to the maximum extent of what their parents could do according to their ability and their experience.
In order to answer your contradiction, yes, we must be independent. What does good parenting involve? Teaching us how to be independent. All these decisions that they make are on the basis of our well-being, which is also including independence in our lives.
Friends, I think you got the statement wrong. The statement isn't whether we have the ability to make decisions on our own or not. It's whether our parents have the ability to make right decisions for us or not. I would like to continue by saying Roger Crawford, a person who was born with no limbs, was told by doctors that there's no hope, there's no point of living. And his parents were the ones who gave him the hope and unconditional love and support to make him a qualified author, public speaker, and qualified tennis player.
My parents made me swim 8 hours a day. That seemed like hell on earth. But what made me who I am today? A national level swimmer, and I am grateful to them. There was once a girl who was bullied incessantly by her peers in America. She found that she can confide in songs by singer and songwriter James Arthur.
Okay, so why do our parents limit us? Why do they limit us to certain things? That's mostly because they're afraid. Because their childhood and our childhood is not really similar, is it? Being a child in the modern world is quite difficult. They are afraid that the things that happen to them may also get repeated with us. So they like try to cut us off from the outside world, try to cut us off from exploring. But if they do so, how do we learn? How do we make mistakes? If they do so, we'll never make mistakes. And if we don't make mistakes, how will we learn? Thank you.
I'm sure all parents in this world sacrifice so many of their desires, their valuable time, their hard work, even their health to the happiness of their children. Therefore, it is this unconditional love and selfless sacrifice that asserts that the parents are the ones who know what's best for their children all the time. Moreover, best is a relative word. What's best for me may not be the best for you. So when we say that parents don't know what's best for their children always, we are talking about best from the parents' perspective. Therefore, they know what is best for their children.
And moreover, I'd like to rebut Team B by saying that parents know what is best for their children because they know the best. Maybe the parents want the child to be exposed to the world. Knowing and pampering the child is not the only way of parenting.
Last round.
As we all know, a mother has a built-in mama bear instinct. When her child is in danger, nothing else matters. Her only goal is to protect her child.
Some of you may say that parents are only grown-up kids. Well, that is exactly our point. They are grown-up kids, so they know what we're going through. They know exactly the mistakes they've made and don't want us to repeat.
No matter how much we grow up in life, no matter how much of hardship and struggle we go through in our life, our parents always know us better. They know us 9 months more.
We would like, before we rest our case, we'd like to leave you all with one simple question. How can the people who taught us the basic difference between right and wrong ever be wrong themselves? Thank you.
Rebutting to what Team C said, I would like to tell that parents, you said, sacrifice all their thoughts or sacrifice their happiness just for the sake of well-being of their children. But I would like to give an example. In the olden days, why did parents emphasize on male children, or why did always people want male kids? That's because the religion says that whenever your last ritual is done by a male, your soul is very peaceful in the heaven. So isn't this called sacrifice? Why are you telling no to a girl child? And also, again, they always think about the best for a child. So suppose, taking my example, I play cricket and I feel cricket is where I can succeed and also studies. But parents nowadays want people.
Okay, I'd like to rebut Team B by saying that, see, in the olden day, please don't drag religion into this because you're going off statement, first of all. And second, the statement talks about after we become a parent, not, you know, planning that we should have a male child or and should not have a female child. After becoming a parent, the parents will take the best decision for their child.
Parents are the ones who have your best interests at heart. Even if the entire world, your society, the entire human race is against you and you run home crying, your parents are the ones who will be there to comfort you, to support you, and who give you the final happiness.
And moreover, the final motive of a parent is not to prove themselves right or to say that, child, you are wrong. It's not that. It is not to prove their point and force it upon the children. It is because they care about the child.
Thank you. Thank you. Call 6 on stage, please. Introduction, please. introduction, please.
A very good afternoon to everyone present here. I am Lubna Firdos and this is Manu Nicholas Jacob, representing Dev Mata Central School, Baneswadi, standing strongly for the statement, teachers need not be very knowledgeable.
Good afternoon, my friends and respected judges. We are from Trimis World School, Electronic City, Phase 1, and today we will be standing against the statement, a teacher need not be very knowledgeable.
My name is Chinmaya and his name is Roshan.
A wonderful afternoon to everybody present here. I'm Namita with my partner Aditi and we're going to be representing Edify School Bengaluru and we are standing strongly for the topic, a teacher need not be very knowledgeable.
A good teacher infuses hope, ignites imagination and instills love for the whole life. A teacher is defined as passion, as leadership, as classroom management and values, not something as cliché as knowledge.
The quality of education depends on what students learn and understand. Let's take for the example Sheldon Cooper from Big Bang Theory. He has a very high IQ. Now if he goes around teaching small children about dark matter, I think it's sufficient to say that will not help anyone.
I would like to contradict your point. You said that something as cliche as knowledge, right? Knowledge refers to everything in life. It's not just about dark matter or something that you read in a book. No. Knowledge means being intelligent and then well informed. It's not something that you just read in a newspaper. No. It means everything that you've experienced in your life, your hopes, your emotions, your ideas. So by saying that teachers are ignite hope, bring love to children, you're basically supporting our point that teachers need to be knowledgeable.
Okay. I would like to respond to Team B. The statement is a teacher need not be very knowledgeable. We never mentioned that a teacher need not be knowledgeable. Anyone who teaches is a teacher, be it singing, one chapter in science, or even cooking. A teacher is someone who expresses knowledge, and no matter how limited it is. Now, let's come into terms with today's world. In today's world, the breadth of knowledge is more important than the depth of knowledge. After all, a teacher's job is to inspire students and encourage their intellectual and emotional growth.
Okay. Now, Team B, I'm indebted to you for bringing up that point. Now, the statement says a teacher need not be very knowledgeable. Yes, we say that teachers need to be knowledgeable, but an excess of anything is detrimental to progress. Now, in the same way, now teaching must be a two-way process, not a top-down process. A top-down process is when the teacher teaches and the students just understand and gulp down what the teacher says. A two-way process is where both the student and the teacher learn from each other, and this actually helps greatly in the student understanding what the teacher has to say.
A teacher needs to have the ability to use knowledge effectively. It is not necessary that she should be very knowledgeable. A teacher should have the small fact of conveying knowledge. For example, a physics teacher who has a lot of knowledge in his field but don't know how to convey it.
Okay, let's break down knowledge. Knowledge is defined as the act of intelligent and well informed. A good teacher is not the one who's prone academics, but is the one who walks into a boring class and changes the entire atmosphere, turns tables. A good teacher needs to have good organization skills, a good creative approach, and open to all ideas and views, different thoughts, and have good time management skills.
Also, I would like to contradict both Team C and A by saying, what do you mean by lot of knowledge, little amount of knowledge? Do you have any definition to what is a medium level of knowledge, little knowledge? No. Knowledge in itself is relative. For a person who can understand even a little bit of physics is rocket science to someone of the old age era. So does that mean that he has little knowledge or very much knowledge? You are talking about something relative.
This is a reply to Team B.
Yes, we are talking in terms of relative knowledge, but what is it relative to? How much the student can understand. Instead of pouring a bucket of knowledge onto a child, which is more than they can take, if you give them a cup and give it to them in a way that they can understand, then that child will grasp the knowledge, and grasping knowledge is more important than just having everything poured on you. And now coming back to our previous point, teachers who are knowledgeable inspire students to learn more and do more by themselves. They don't spoon feed them.
If a teacher is very knowledgeable but not good at conveying the message to their students, then what is the point? A teacher needs to be able to summarize the information and give it to their students in a way that their students will grasp it. Being very knowledgeable isn't the only factor to being a good teacher. A good teacher needs to have communication skills in order to connect with their students.
Now saying back again, now knowledge is relative, yes, but now in schools, a teacher's knowledge depends on how well she knows her subject and how much she knows more than her subject. Now a teacher knows her subject enough, now she has an IQ, let's say 250. Now if she is not able to actually convey what she wants to say to her students in a nice way, then that's not helping anyone.
A teacher needn't be very knowledgeable, as knowledge alone can't make a child successful in life. It is, you know, the life dreamt need not to be pursued only by knowledge. It is by your character as well.
Now again, a good teacher both teaches and learns from her students. Now this is not at all a characteristic of a teacher with a lot of knowledge. Thank you.
I would like to reiterate again, characters are actually forged by knowledge. So again, you're helping us. And another thing I would like to contradict Team C, I never said that they have to pour a bucket on them. I said that they have a bucket and they're giving cup at a time. The better the teacher, the more information they have and the more they can help other people.
And friends, information is available everywhere, on internet, on books, everywhere we find information. But it is up to the teacher who molds the information and makes it understandable to all the people over there.
Which requires knowledge. And the more knowledge you have, the better you make them understand. And the better you make them understand, the more their character is forged. And the more their character is forged, the better they are.
Responding to Team B. What? You can't tell that a person is knowledgeable based on how much knowledge their teacher gives them. The main aim of knowledge and providing it is so that the person understands. Instead of learning everything about quantum mechanics, if I just know a few of the basic things and that's all I can take, that's all that's important.
A teacher must have an engaging personality and a good teaching style. If a teacher doesn't interact with their students, if a teacher doesn't talk to their students, and especially if the students don't like the teacher, then what is the students gonna learn in class? What are they gonna do? Just sit there and listen? A student needs to be very interactive, and that can only happen with good communication skill, good help and support from the teacher. The goal of being a teacher is not to teach how much you know. The goal of a teacher is to make sure the student understands what you're teaching and to make sure that the student applies it where it is required.
Last round.
A very knowledgeable teacher will be put off by the questions a student asks if it's very simple. This will sound very simple to her and she will just think that it's not necessary for me to actually delve into the details of this question. Now, a little less knowledgeable teacher who is more interactive with her students and is able to actually be intrigued by the questions her students ask her is much better for the development of her students. Now, I would like to end with a quote saying, every child deserves a motivator in a teacher. An adult who never gives up on them, understands the power of connection, and insists on becoming the best human being. Thank you.
I would like to reiterate for the third time, you are talking about personality, which is again created by knowledge. I'm not talking about the bookish knowledge, the knowledge there about quantum mechanics. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about their experiences, how they are. That is created by knowledge. I know that quantum mechanics is knowledge, but it's not only knowledge. So therefore, if, as you said, someone can learn quantum mechanics but doesn't know how to teach them. That's not what I mean. For knowledge, it's knowing quantum mechanics and teaching. That's what knowledge is total. And also, if you just know a few basic things, how will you ever evolve? I know I'm going slightly off topic, but...
And in this modern era, teachers need to adapt. Let's go back to Darwin's theory, survival of the fittest. And teachers need to mold the information and make it more interesting, make it more lively, to make all people of different levels, different castes, or whatever, different differences, understand.
I'd like to respond to Team B. The statement is teachers need not be very knowledgeable. Experiences don't make you very greatly knowledgeable. They make you knowledgeable. That is what makes you know things. It's not that you have a great knowledge in a specific thing. And now to our conclusion. Teachers are architects and students are the builders. What do architects do? They guide the builders, they plan. And the students, as the builders, we follow that path and explore our full potential. Therefore, we firmly believe that teachers need not be very knowledgeable. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'll be calling out for the call sheets 11, 12, and 13. Call number 11, PSBB Learning Academy, Aishwarya and Sahit, Sanskar CBSE School, Fabi and Chinmahi, Chrysalis I Elanka, Charvi and Panduranga. Please collect your call sheets and statement outside. Call 12, Royal Concord International School, Abhiram and Prithvi, Vidyashilp Academy, Saujanya and Evoni, Kenshri School, Niranjan and Shaunak. Call 13, Innisfree House School, Shaida and Sumida, Kenshri School, Vrinda and Tanvi, Chinmaya Vidyalaya CBSE, Aditi and Ritika. Please collect your statements and call sheets out. Mentor who have not received their mentor note, please can come and collect your.
Call 7 on stage, please. Yeah, that's okay. Return points is allowed. Please.
A very pleasant morning to everyone present here. This is Rohit Agarwal with Pratiksha Arra and representing Green Valley English School. And this is all to you mentors. We love you all.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here. I'm Nikita. This is my partner Nadeep. We're representing Vidyashilp Academy and we are for the statement.
Jai Gurudev and good afternoon everyone. I am Rakshita and this is my friend Ankita. And we are from Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Vidya Mandir, Bangalore South. And we are strongly against the statement, Verbattle should do away with mentors. Start.
So
basically, it's very important for every person to have a constant supporting system. Basically, it's very important for every person to have a constant supporting system. So it's very important for a person to have a constant supporting system. So it's very important to have a mentor. Why? Because a mentor helps you out in excelling yourself. He helps you to channelize things and interpret statements, especially the statements which are given in the platform like Verbattle.
It helps us having dual impact, that is students' ideas plus mentors' inputs, that will help us have a directed flow of our ideas in an interpreted manner that is very necessary in the platform like Verbattle. Over to you, Team B.
So the four principles of Verbattle is debate, democracy, communication, and leadership. The vision of Verbattle is to shape leaders for today and tomorrow. If we want to be the leaders of tomorrow, we must think about what's coming ahead of us. We will not have a mentor walking us through every step. There is no safety net in the real world. When we get our statements, we must think. We must understand, and then we must speak.
A mentor, someone who helps us guide and develop ourselves towards our career and towards good things.
A mentor is a person who guides us from the path of darkness into light. So, how many of us here are without a mentor? Can I have a raise of hand? So, this exactly proves our point, that Verbattle should have a mentor.
I would like to rebattle Team B by telling that you told us the four principles of Verbattle, and to cherish it, we want a mentor. Without a mentor, nothing is possible in this world. Over to Team A.
Mentors provide us with emotional and intellectual support. They are experienced persons, so they are trustworthy and reliable. They are better problem solvers, and their experience, so they can help us out in the stage like Verbattle. The statements we get, to cherish our ideas. As per Team C said, I totally agree that point. To cherish our ideas and to replenish it and to implement it, it's very much necessary to have a mentor support, because without it, we do nothing.
A mentor is not just who is promise maker, he is promise keeper. So mentor is really very important so that we can rely on him. He's trustworthy. We can execute our ideas in a proper way. Over to you, Team B.
The whole point of Verbattle is to use your views, your opinions, and your understanding to give the best performance on stage. We have stage to bring out our confidence.
In answering to your rebuttal, so one of the principles is leadership. They're referring to us as the leaders of the future, not the mentors. If we're solely relying on the mentors and using their opinions, how can we become the leaders if we're relying on their opinions? And again, the whole essence of Verbattle is lost if we rely on the mentors for their opinions. And it completely defeats the purpose of the students.
So I would like to contradict Team B by telling that
Yeah.
Hello. So I would like to rebattle Team B by telling that they are not here to put their vision in us. They are just here to guide us and take us in the right path. Also, every great achiever was inspired by a great mentor. We in this generation, we do more smart work than hard work. So I would like to tell that getting a great mentor is like getting a shortcut to success. And I don't think anyone was to do hard work in this generation like a donkey. We choose smart work. Over to Team A.
I like to rebut Team B's by saying that. It's just what we say and what we meant to say. It's just by the understanding, actually. That's what being helped by a mentor. An effective mentor will help us by leading us and by listening us and not just by lecturing.
I would just like to give you an example of Chandragupta Maurya, the conqueror. All of you know him, right? Chandragupta Maurya, the conqueror. So he became the conqueror. Why? Because a mentor was there behind him who headed him towards becoming the conqueror. That was Chanakya. So that's what I want to tell it to Team B, that it's not just whatever we are saying or whatever we are meaning, what we meant. It is how it is understood, how people interpret it. So a coach or a mentor will listen to it, especially in the stage like Verbattle. They listen to it and also they understand it, they interpret it, and they help us channelize it. That's what was our point.
So answering to your rebuttal, again, I agree, you need a mentor to guide you. But there is a difference in a...
So again, if I'm with my mentor, we both have a difference in opinion. So the mentor's opinion might essentially affect my opinion as well, right? So we're back.